I'm finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need.
Well, Christ, let's just spend a couple of minutes, just getting up, moving around, getting the blood circulating. My goodness gracious, that might be a good thing to do. So let's greet one another for a few minutes.
Don't know what she wants me to be guessing. That would be helpful to know.
Yeah. Then it wouldn't be guessing.
Yeah. Then I would know.
Okay. Go ahead.
That's good.
I was inside all week. It doesn't grow very fast.
Oh, is that what it is? Well, try a little fertilizer. Okay. Yeah. Well, welcome in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to y'all who are streaming in. I'm glad you're with us. I hope you have a good, meaningful time. Now, we've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. The usual stuff is going on this way. Oh, by the way, we got soup pickup after service. So if you've ordered soup, we're going to pick it up today. It'll be ready for you in the fellowship hall, so you can go and get it then. Let's see. Anything else related to soup? I think we're good. The usual stuff, we got Bible study on Wednesday. Oh, with respect to Bible study, it's in the bulletin, but just want to take to note it. A couple of folks have asked if it would be possible to have a study in the evening. Actually, summer's not a bad time to have it in the evening because it stays lighter longer. And I told the person who asked that if we could get five people that would say, yes, I'm interested in coming for an evening study or afternoon, well, evening study, let me know when we can get something started and we can study any of a number of things. But if that's something that you're interested in, let me know and we can start looking at a time and a day to meet. So that's in the bulletin. Now, the usual stuff is going on this week. Next week, we got a lot of stuff because on Sunday, know that we've got the Palm Sunday brunch that y'all are invited to attend. Now, the deacons want a casserole, right? I'm looking at Brother Jake back there. If you could bring some kind of an egg casserole, a cover dish to share, that would, as opposed to a cover dish that's empty for you to take home. You wanted to, I like the other, yes. But so you bring a cover dish to share and the beverage, coffee and juice and stuff, that'll be provided. And we got sausage, and I understand the sausage, Jess, is pre-cooked. Is that right, Jess? The sausage is pre-cooked?
No, we're not
going to pre-cook it. Okay, so. so we've gone past pre-cooked. So, that was Alice? Alice. So we're going to, but it'll be sausage and bacon and all kinds of good stuff. So you want to come to that, yeah. I don't think there'll be any, unless somebody brings gravy, but Cass, you're cooking? Uh-huh. So that's good. That's what we're going to be doing on Palm Sunday, next Sunday, and then we're going to have Monday Thursday service. Yes. The cantata on Sunday afternoon, next Sunday afternoon. Good Friday. Right. Right. So Palm Sunday, we got that would have been unfortunate. It's in the bulletin. It's also on the bulletin board at the, got it. So you might want to attend that on Monday, Thursday. We're going to have a simple meal like we did last year, soup and bread. And we are will share communion, but we'll do it in the fellowship hall. And at the request of certain members of the session, I don't want to point any of them out. There's going to be no foot washing. Right, Trista? Okay, so don't worry. If you see a basin, we're going to be washing hands, not feet. And then I'm sorry, Van, that we're not doing that. Then on Friday, we're going to have that 6:30. On Friday, we're going to have a Good Friday service, a tenebrae service here at 7 o'clock. And tenebrae means shadows, so we did it last year. It'll be a service of shadows as we kind of prepare ourselves for we'll hear the passion story. And so we'll do that. And then, of course, on Sunday, there is Easter. So mark your calendars accordingly. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
They're also doing
Okay. Will they have biscuits and gravy? Okay. Sorry. Not even there. Any other announcements? So thank you, Tristan. Any other announcements? Yes. Who might that be? Jay. Now, Jake, are you telling me that personally? Is that directed at me personally or just in general? Okay. And with all deference and respect to you, we will not sing "Happy Birthday to You." Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jake. Happy birthday to you. We will not be singing that song. Okay. Any other announcements? Well, then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together.
Holy Spirit, come and fill this place with your presence. Embolden us to spread the fire of your Spirit. This day may we devote ourselves to teaching and prayer. And let us pray as Saint Augustine. Breathe in us, O Holy Spirit, that our thoughts may all be holy. Act in us, O Holy Spirit, that our work too may be holy. Draw our hearts, O Holy Spirit, that we love but what is holy. Strengthen us, O Holy Spirit, to defend all that is holy. Guard us then, O Holy Spirit, that we always may be holy. May we never cease to be amazed at your works, and may we always remember that you are with us. Amen.
Well, let's all stand up and let's get the blood flowing by singing some songs. And we'll start by singing "Spirit of the Living God." Thank you. Y'all may be seated. And Scott, you got into that last one, didn't you? Yeah, you were really, really cooking. Yeah, you were feeling that. That's good. Hey, ladies, come on up. Have a seat, if you would. Now, I said ladies, because I didn't see any gentlemen here. So, that's why I said ladies. Well, how are y'all doing? Good, 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 good. Let's see, anything new or exciting going on in your lives? Nothing? You've got a gala? Well, now, tell me, do you know what a gala is? I don't know what it is either. What is a gala? Oh, it's a dance thing. Okay, so you do dancing. Okay, what's that? Are you going to do it here, or do you go someplace? You go someplace to have a gala. Okay, and is it? It's fun. It's a fun thing to do. Okay, well that's pretty cool. That's really neat. I always enjoy seeing your pictures on Facebook of you. Now, did you have green hair? Didn't you have a wig that had green? Didn't I see a picture of you with green hair?
Yeah, Beetlejuice.
You did a Beetlejuice song?
No, Beetlejuice dance.
Beetlejuice dance. And so you had green hair?
Yeah.
It wasn't your real hair green?
No.
Oh, it was a wig. Okay. Okay, because... Well, Come on. We were talking about Beetlejuice. A Beetlejuice wig. Now, you know what Beetlejuice is? Do you know what Beetlejuice is? Okay. I do, only because I saw a show on Beetlejuice. So, you didn't actually cut your hair and dye it green? You wore a wig? Okay. All right. Well, that makes sense. Anything exciting happening in your life? Anything new? Oh, nothing new. I know I like your butterfly pad. The pad you had, that's really, really cool with that butterfly. I thought that was really neat. Well, you know, have you ever been frustrated? Do you know what the word frustrated means? Okay, what does the word frustrated mean? That's exactly right. In other words, it's the story of my life. It's every day going to work. That's an example of frustrated. Now, would you all do me a favor? Frustrated is when you're trying to do something or trying to find something and you can't find it. Let me see on your face how your face looks when you're frustrated. When you're trying to find something and you can't find it. Let me see frustration. Oh, Ray Ray, that is excellent. That is an excellent face. That kind of scares me a little bit. Okay, so sometimes we get frustrated, right? Okay. Well, because I'm frustrated. Sometimes. Have you ever been afraid? Ooh. What are some things that make you afraid? Ooh. That scared you, didn't it? That made you scared. The rec center makes you afraid? What's that? The rec center is haunted? I didn't know that. Wow. Does the borough council know that the rec center is haunted? I mean, that would seem to be something they'd need to know. Maybe the Beetlejuice. I thought it connected, you know, being haunted and all. Okay, so what are some, so you're afraid of, might be afraid of haunted things. What else could be? Makes you afraid. The dark? Okay, dark is kind of, you're afraid of the dark? Dark can be afraid because you don't know what's out there. You don't know what's around. So let me see if we're this frustrated. You know, let me see scared. You can't, well, that was close.
That's excited.
Oh, that's an excited face? Well, a lot of times when I'm excited, I'm also scared. So it's the same kind of face. Well, what we're going to talk about, we're not going to talk about being frustrated. We're not going to talk about being scared. But we are going to talk about when we feel frustrated and we feel scared, God gives us something right here. Oh, man, you're good at frustrated, Ray Ray. God gives us something that'll help us calm down. Because sometimes when we're frustrated, we get kind of confused. And when we're scared, we kind of get confused. God gives us something that will kind of calm us down when we're feeling frustrated or feeling afraid. And you know what that thing is that God gives us? It's called the Spirit. It's called the Spirit. It's called the Holy Spirit. And he places it right here. And it just kind of calms us down when we're feeling afraid or when we're frustrated. Because that Spirit tells us that it's going to be okay. That God is in control and we're going to be okay. Okay, and that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to be talking about the Spirit that God puts inside of us and how that Spirit can help us. Okay? So let's bow our heads. You're really good at Ray. Are you frustrated a lot?
Yes.
Is that she's frustrated a lot? A lot. Okay. Because you're really good with that face. That's even with lipstick, you look still good. Oh, she's mean. We don't want to talk. You're mean? You're agreeing with that? Okay, let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us your Spirit, because when we're frustrated and when we're afraid, we know that Spirit will calm us down. Thank you. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, ladies, up. Okay, see, look, I got it. So we you know what we said. Now, have a wonderful week. And what do I want you to remember all week long?
God loves us.
And? Happy Easter. Almost. You thought it was okay.
Happy Easter almost.
Okay. And you can pick up a flyer right there and some crayons. And I'll tell you, when you fill out the puzzle, when you leave, you can show it to me as you pass by. Well, we come to the part of the service where we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, we've got some particular needs that are in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Are there any updates or corrections to any of the things that are in the bulletin? Anything we want to add? Oh, Marcy. Thank you, Bill.
Unfortunately found out about a little over a week ago he has to retire early from work. He's 56. He's having to have a defibrillator and a pacemaker installed. Once they said the word defibrillator, that was it for his trucking. He's done. So, and he's having it on the 17th, and it's, you know, it's an anxious thing. You don't know. He's had a couple of heart attacks.
Oh, my. At 56?
At 56.
Wow.
So,
so we want to lift Mike up in our prayers for both the medical, physical problems, but also the emotional, you know, having to retire, and that's always hard. Anything else? Yes, Cass.
Prayer for Sherry.
Yes, absolutely. Wow. Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you, Cass. Yes. Wow. Absolutely. So we want to, Samantha, we want to lift up Samantha in our prayers. Thank you. Yes. Yes, Sister Shelley, tore her rotator cuff, and there's a tear, and she's in a lot of discomfort, and she has problems with her arm anyway, so we want to lift up. If she's not part of the trio, it's missed. I almost said you're missing a stooge, but that would be a horrible thing to say. That would be really inappropriate. We'll just let it go. Anything else? Well, then with these in mind and also the concerns we know within our own heart, let's go to God now in prayer, and I'll open and pray for a little bit. Part of the prayer will be confession, because we're going to be hearing God's word read and proclaimed in just a little bit, and we need to get ready for that. Y'all will have the opportunity to lift your prayers to God, and then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go before God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you for giving us this day. My goodness gracious. It was last week, it was rainy, and the wind was blowing, and some folks lost power, and that's a real pain, but today, the sun is out, it feels like spring, and we really appreciate it. So thank you for being so gracious to us and so loving in the weather that you bring. Thank you. Now, in just a little bit, we're going to hear your word read and proclaimed, and we're going to be focused today on spirit. And Lord, there's something we need to confess. Even though we have received your spirit, because your spirit is a gift that we don't control, often we either don't recognize it as there or we don't appreciate what it offers. We form our own opinions. We decide our own paths, our own journeys, as though you're not involved in our life at all. Or when problems come up, we kind of trust those around us to help us through rather than to rely on a presence that's there. Although this is your gift to us, often we don't even recognize that it's been given. And we're sorry about that, Lord, because you gave it to us for a reason, to help support us and to strengthen us and to enable us to be the people you've called us to be. And so when we don't appreciate that, we ask for your forgiveness. We also ask that you redirect our attention so that we not only recognize what's there, but claim its power and its comfort and its strength. In the name of Christ, we pray. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you the needs that are in the bulletin, and we're going to lay before you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us now as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us And thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, thank you for forgiving us. And we believe we've been forgiven. That's what you promised. We also thank you for responding to our needs. And we believe you'll do that as well. Because we've lifted up these needs in the name of Christ our Savior, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would the ushers please come forward to collect our offering?
edification, that our gifts may be put to good and effective. In the name of Christ we
pray. Amen. Now, considering the showers and the wind we've had the last few days, I think it is pretty obvious that we have entered. Thank you! Man, y'all gave me a start there for a little bit. Of course, I think we all know what that means, you know, entering spring. Before we know it, the air is going to, well, even now, it's getting warmer. It's going to continue to get warmer. And the day is even now getting a little bit longer. And inhale, if you would. The smell of deacon-made soup has gotten stronger, at least around here. And so the rain that we've had is really a reminder that we're turning the corner, because everybody knows that April showers bring and May flowers bring. Pilgrims, thank you very much, Ed, thank you. I appreciate it. Boy, that'll get you a big laugh in third grade. All things considered, the world seems to be turning the corner, and we're heading in the right direction. And I say that even though with every single thunderstorm that accompanies the rain, Debbie and I have to deal with what? A shaky, nervous Coco Chanel. Of course, along with all this other stuff that's happening, the coming of spring is a reminder that Easter is on the way, which means we're soon going to be finishing up this sermon series we started back in February, one entitled Easter in 7 Words. I mean, as most of y'all know, as we are approaching the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we've been looking at some of the words that the Apostle Paul considered really important. And over the last 4 weeks, we've talked about grace, that incredible gift given to us by God, and faith, you know, the decision to trust that the gift was given without strings or conditions. And then we focused on peace, a word that pretty much describes the relationship we have with our gracious Lord when we respond with faith. And then light, that personal presence that God puts within us that we have the opportunity to shine in an otherwise dark world. Now, that's what we've been talking about. And this morning, we're going to discuss something else that God has given to us, but that only has meaning when we trust that it's there. And now I'm talking about Spirit, in particular, the Holy Spirit. And in a sense, that Spirit that God gives is not unlike the light that we discussed last week, but with one pretty significant difference. Instead of being something that was given so that we could share it with others, that's kind of what the light is, God's Spirit is something that helps us be what we were created to be and to do what we were called to do. And I'll tell you personally, I'm really glad that God did this, that God has given us the Spirit, because without some help, I think sharing His life can be really, really challenging, can't it? I mean, that's really hard to do. I mean, I don't know if you've noticed this, maybe you haven't, but the world around us is a pretty tough place, right? And when I pause and just think about being a light both out there and even in here, well, I'll tell you, I can understand how Coco Chanel feels in the middle of a thunderstorm. I mean, it's a pretty scary prospect. Good night, nurse. When I start thinking about my own personal limitations and the mess that's happening all around and the fear that at the very best, we're just going to see more of the same, right, as we go forward, left on my own, I seriously doubt that I'm going to be anything much better than a flashlight with a dying battery in the middle of a dark and cluttered basement. Now, that's sometimes how I feel. And I'll tell you, I don't think I'm alone. But you know, according to what Paul wrote, I think God recognized this problem. You know, this feeling that a lot of us have, maybe most of us have. And that's the reason God has given us the Spirit. And so with that in mind, we're going to spend a little time with Romans 8, 1 through 11. Scripture in which Paul talked about one of his favorite topics, namely the Holy Spirit. And during our discussion, we're going to focus on three things that the Spirit offers that can not only make us just plain better people, and y'all want to be better people? I know I do. It can make us better people, but will also enable us to share the good news of grace and faith, peace and light to others. Now, that's what we're going to be doing for the next 10 minutes or so. For example, according to what Paul wrote to the Romans, the Spirit offers us a new sense of freedom. And I'm talking about freedom from our own past. Now, for him, I think that's the first thing that the Spirit offers us. And I'll tell you, I think that's pretty good news for us all, because let's get real, if we're not careful, it's incredibly easy for us to become almost enslaved to what we were and what we've done. I mean, I don't think it's much of a stretch to assume that we can slip into that being controlled by our past, right? For instance, I think it's really easy to assume that we will never have the opportunity to compensate for opportunities that we may have missed. That's really easy for us to assume. And to assume that we will never get past the mistakes that we've already made. And that we will never be forgiven by some of the people we've already hurt. Now, that's some of the kind of stuff I think we often assume. And for that reason, if we're not careful, the past can become, well, it can become like a yoke strapped to our shoulders, constantly weighing us down. Or maybe an anchor chained to our waist, continually holding us back. And since the past is one thing in this world, in fact, it may be one of the few things in this world over which we have absolutely no control. We don't have any control about the past. Not only can regrets wear us down, they can blind us to all the possibilities and opportunities that are all around us. I'll tell you, when our past controls our present, man, we are in big trouble. But you know, I believe Paul understood that. And that's why he wrote this to the Romans. If you belong to Christ Jesus, you won't be punished. The Holy Spirit will give you life that comes from Christ Jesus and will set you free from sin and death. The law of Moses cannot do this because our selfish desires make the law weak. But God set you free when he sent his own son to be like us sinners and to be a sacrifice for our sin. God used Christ's body to condemn sin. He did this so that we would do what the law commands by obeying the Spirit instead of our own desires. You see, according to Paul, we have been set free. We've been set free. We've been set free from sin. We've been set free from the past. And we have been set free from all those things that can push us down and hold us back. We are free. But let's get real. I'm not stupid. Like I said a minute ago, we can't control the past. Therefore, we can't take a mulligan and recapture the opportunities we missed and correct the mistakes we've made and ease the pain that we've caused. We can't do that. still we don't have to do what we've done anymore. And we don't have to stay where we've been anymore. And we don't have to continue to be who we were anymore. Because we're free. We can be better. It's like Paul wrote to the Corinthians. Anyone who belongs to Christ is a new person. The past is forgotten and everything is new. I'm telling you. Straps have been broken. Therefore, the yoke can be taken off. The chain has been cut. Therefore, the anchor can be left behind. And now we have the possibility to become everything God has created and called us to be. Why? Because the Spirit offers us a new sense of freedom. And according to this passage, that's the first thing it offers. But of course, that's not all. Because second, it also offers us a new focus to claim. And you know, if it didn't, man, we would be in big trouble. You see, since we've been set free from the past, free from the regret, free from the yoke and the anchor, we're kind of like blank slates, right? We've been set free from all that junk, right? That no longer binds us. We are like blank slates. I mean, all those assumptions that gave us meaning and stability, and all those desires that provided us direction and purpose, man, stick a fork in them, they are gone. And let's get real. If we decide, as blank slates, if we decide to look into the world that, for reasons I don't understand, often seems unconcerned by this weird combination of arrogance and ignorance, if we look there for meaning, and if we listen to those who tell us that love for self should trump love for neighbor, if we listen to them for direction, man, we're going to be worse off than we were before. I'm telling you, just because we believe that we've been set free from the past doesn't automatically mean we got a clear focus on how to live in the present, do we? Am I not right? Now, that's our problem. But fortunately, our problem isn't new. And I believe that's why Paul wrote this to the Romans. He wrote, "People who are ruled by their desires think only of themselves. Everyone who is ruled by the Holy Spirit thinks about spiritual things. If our minds are ruled by our desires, we will die. But if our minds are ruled by the Spirit, we will have life and peace." Our desires fight against God because they do not and cannot obey God's laws. If we follow our desires, we cannot please God. Now, that's what Paul said, and I want you to think about what that means. You see, right here and right now, we don't have to be ruled by our desires. We don't have to be. That's like being tied to the past. We don't have to find meaning and values that sure seem to be a distortion of what Jesus Christ taught, the grace and the love and the mercy that he told us to show. And we sure as heck don't have to listen to those voices who, for a variety of reasons, tell us to only think of ourselves and disregard the need of our neighbors. We don't have to do that. As people who have received grace, as people who have responded with faith, as people who are at peace with God, and as people whom God has filled with his light, these values and these voices, man, they can be dead to us. Nailed to the cross. And in their place, we can concentrate our attention on claiming life and peace, on showing love and compassion, because that's what the law of God commands. In other words, right here and now, we can decide to think about what Paul called spiritual things. Why? Because the Spirit offers us a new focus to claim. And according to this passage, that's the second thing it offers. And third, for Paul, the Spirit also offers a new reason for hope. A new reason to look past the confusion. A new reason to move forward into the future with confidence. And I don't know about y'all, but this moving into the future with confidence, that's something that is tailor-made for us nowadays. At least it is in my opinion. I mean, good night, nurse. We are constantly bombarded with all kinds of reasons we should be afraid, aren't we? Man, that's all we hear, is reasons to be afraid. For example, do you realize that right now, illegal immigrants are pouring across the border? I'm talking about pouring like water. And each one of them, man, woman, and baby, are bringing with them what? Crime and drugs and disease. Did you realize that? And I haven't even started talking about the fact that right now, because of global warming, the ice caps are melting. And any minute, we are going to be underwater. Did you realize that? Tell me we shouldn't be afraid. You know what else they're doing? They're canceling our history. But they're also banning our books. Bob, you know what I'm talking about. And I'll tell you something else. Do you realize that if you either decide to be woke or support MAGA, you will bring destruction to the United States? And end life as we know it. Am I not right? Well, depending on your source of information, I am half right, right? But I'm not going to tell you which half, because that varies depending on where you get your news. What has happened to us? What's happened to us? Have we lost our stupid minds? Wouldn't have seen this 50 years ago. And since those who provide that information understand that fear, what? Sells. And they're broadcasting 24/7. And their revenues are based on advertising, which are based on ratings. No wonder we become obsessed with negativity and scared of anybody who disagrees with us. We have become a society grounded in fear. But not only that, motivated by fear. And so it's no surprise that a whole bunch of Americans have such a bleak view of the future and are willing to seek out any port in the midst of this storm. But again, I don't think that perspective is all that new either. According to what Paul wrote to the Romans were scared. And that's why he wrote this. You are no longer ruled by your desires, but by God's Spirit who lives in you. People who don't have the Spirit of Christ in them don't belong to Him. But Christ lives in you. So you are alive because God has accepted you, even though your bodies must die because of your sins. Yet, God raised Jesus to what? Life. God's Spirit now lives in you, and He will raise you to life by His Spirit. God will raise you to life by His Spirit. Now, that's what Paul said, and I think that's important for us to remember. You see, we have the Spirit living in us. We have the Spirit living in us, and we know the truth that comes from God. And we trust that just like God raised Jesus to life, one day He is going to do the exact same thing for us. Right, Ed? Yes, sir. God is in control. And I'm telling you, He holds our destiny in His hands. not only our destiny, but the destiny of creation in his hands. Now, do you believe that? Do you believe that? Man, I hope you do. If you leave here and believe nothing else, I hope you believe that. And even though for me, that doesn't mean we should simply ignore the very real problems we face, put on rose-colored glasses and kind of drift along. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to be afraid. Instead, we can choose to listen to God before we listen to anybody else. And we can choose to trust that his presence is always with us. And we can feel it when together we are doing what God has called us to do. And brothers and sisters, we can choose to move forward with confidence and not fear, believing that Paul knew exactly what he was talking about when he wrote this. I am sure that nothing can separate us from God's love. Not death, not life or death, not angels or spirits, not the present or the future, not powers above or powers below. Nothing in all creation can separate us from God's love for us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Sentence ends. You see, this we can do. Why? Because the Spirit offers us a new reason for hope. And that's the third thing it offers. Now, without a doubt, all signs are pointing to spring, right? What's the word? Yeah, good. All signs are pointing to spring. But you know, along with the warmer air and the longer days and the faint smell of stuffed peppers and broccoli and vegetable beef, we'll also have a few thunderstorms that will scare the puddin' out of Coco Chanel. That's the way it is. But I'll tell you, I think the same thing applies to more than just little white dogs. Man, our world is a tough place. Always was, and always will be. And for that reason, it's always going to be challenging for people to shine God's light in the darkness, regardless of the amount of grace they've been given or the amount of faith they show or the amount of peace they have. That's also just the way it is. But praise the Lord, God has given us the Spirit. And that Spirit offers us a new sense of peace and a new focus to claim and a new source for hope. And you know, I think this is something we need to remember as we approach Easter, but also as we move on with our lives. And next week, we'll move to Paul's sixth word, humility. I'm sorry. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us, thank you for giving us the Spirit. My goodness gracious, what would we be without your Spirit? Wow. We'd be tied to the past, our past, shaped by those things that we can't control. We'd be moving back and forth by a world that seems confused and maybe a world that has some malice. We'd be scared of the future. Thank you for your Spirit. Because through that Spirit, we have a sense of freedom. The past doesn't control us. And through that freedom, Spirit, we can claim a new hope, a new direction. And through that Spirit, we have a brand new source of hope. Lord, help us to claim that as we go about living our lives. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, before we close the service by singing a song, I offer to you all this invitation. If there's anybody here who might feel the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and is interested in how he or she might respond, talk to me after the service. If you've got a question about the sermon or the service, talk to me about that as well. Let's sing Spirit Song. And Jake, let's sing one verse. Let's sing one verse of Spirit Song. Let's all stand. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. And I'll tell you, if you don't spend some time enjoying this sunshine, just saying. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. And remember, the Holy Spirit is in you. The Holy Spirit is in you. Therefore, feel that sense of freedom. Claim that purpose and grasp that hope. And to inspire the walk, this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. Amen.